Nearly 10 years after 9/11, the world's most wanted man is very much alive. Somewhere, Osama bin Laden plans mass attacks on civilians all around the world. And at the top of his hit list is the President of the United States. This is the inside story of the people who confronted that threat.
I think I felt the enormous weight of the information I've been told.
Intelligence agents who crack bin Laden's inner circle.
The drama of those events is inescapable. It's an intensity I'll never forget.
A president who made a decision against the odds.
The stakes were just too damn high.
And the elite Navy SEALs who got the job done.
They were getting to go and kill the most wanted man on the planet.
This was a big gamble.
We will smoke them out of their holes, and we'll bring them to justice.
For years, it was like chasing a ghost.
We never stopped chasing him. Never stopped looking for clues.
They used to put out there in the old West a wanted poster. It said, wanted dead or alive.
What we ended up doing was chasing a lot of dry holes.
When was the last time you knew where he was? Tora Bora, December 2001.
What you had was a period of bin Laden going dark, not being on the grid.
The president to kind of look up from his desk and just say, where are we, Mike?
We still haven't killed or captured Osama bin Laden and his terrorist cadre. Do you happen to know where he is?
I don't know where he is.
There were theories as to whether or not he could be in Iran, maybe in Afghanistan.
Even the closest people to Osama bin Laden cannot tell where he is.
Some of the things that were suggested as intelligence look more like Elvis sightings.
A number of people thought he was actually dead.
In the years after 9/11, the U.S. and its allies fight two wars and spend billions of dollars. But the world's most wanted man eludes them. And Al-Qaeda attacks continue.
It's very frustrating not to see the leader of Al-Qaeda, the man responsible for 9/11 and atrocities around the world, not be found for over 10 years.
Then in 2007, CIA Director Michael Hayden gets a briefing and a new idea.
The folks in the Osama bin Laden cell said, we think we've got a plan that will increase the odds for us to catch bin Laden.
If they're not going to pick up the phone, if they're not going to email, if they're not going to engage in sort of corporate leadership sessions, how else are they going to communicate?
That's people. Couriers, trusted individuals who were flesh and blood, who moved around, who could be tracked, could be identified, and ultimately could prove to be the key back into bin Laden's lair.
The couriers are the nervous system of Al-Qaeda, the way parts of its body talk to each other. Couriers deliver the leadership's attack plans and order terror cells into action. If the CIA can unlock the way this organization communicates, then they can kill it. Across northwest Pakistan and the Afghan border, couriers will drive 100 miles before turning on their cell phones to make a single call. And regularly destroy their SIM cards. Their techniques are primitive, but they keep the courier network one step ahead of America's high technology, allowing Al-Qaeda cells to operate without leaving an electronic trace. But slowly there's progress. A single name repeated again and again. The Man from Kuwait. The code name of a super courier who serves the very highest Al-Qaeda leaders. And maybe Bin Laden himself. They drop Kuwaiti's name on the most important Al-Qaeda prisoners in Guantanamo Bay. In this world, a no can be as useful as a yes.
They were usually cooperative. They were usually truth-telling. And in this case, they almost emotionally try to wave us off. Oh, he's of no importance. He used to do some things.
Kuwaiti becomes a key target of every U.S. intelligence agency. But with no idea of his real name, his location, or his phone numbers, the trail goes cold again.
You didn't know what would happen tomorrow. When's the next big one going to come up? Did we miss an operative? Are we going to be responsible for the deaths of another 3,000 innocents? The drama of those events is inescapable. It's an intensity I'll never forget.
In 2008, a presidential candidate promises to do whatever it takes to catch Osama bin Laden.
When I was running for the presidential seat, I had emphasized that Al-Qaeda had to be our number one target. If Pakistan is unable or unwilling to hunt down bin Laden and take him out, then we should.
Barack Obama's foreign policy speechwriter helps articulate this aggressive strategy.
The mistake I think we had made by 2008, 2009, is to think that we'll never get this guy, that he's faded to black.
We seem to have lost track of the fact that the reason we went into Afghanistan in the first place was to go after Al-Qaeda and bin Laden, their main operational leader.
The new president gives CIA Director Leon Panetta an order.
He said to Leon, you need to put a lot more resources on this, and we need to intensify this effort to find Osama bin Laden.
This had to be our highest priority within the CIA, because I felt that if we could get bin Laden, we could gain momentum in dismantling Al-Qaeda.
There's more money and more resources as men and monitoring equipment are switched from Iraq to the Afghan-Pakistani border.
Whatever extra effort needed to be undertaken, the president wanted to make sure that was going to be done from the beginning.
With this new focus comes a new insight. Elite Al-Qaeda couriers can't always destroy their phones.
You can throw all your phones away, but you pay a price in speed, you pay a price in agility. So we find they don't throw their phones away. They try to be careful, but they don't throw them away.
Pakistani intelligence shares information about the most important Al-Qaeda couriers. From that and other more secret sources, the CIA puts together a list of phone numbers. One of them may belong to the mysterious Al-Kuwaiti himself. Months pass as the National Security Agency monitors millions of calls from thousands of numbers. A huge electronic surveillance effort that takes technology and skill, but most of all, patience.
They run an automated system of name, text, number, and voice recognition.
Finally, during the summer of 2010, an NSA computer in Baltimore listens in on a cell phone conversation.
He's talking.
A man in northwest Pakistan is speaking in Arabic to a friend from the Gulf States, a known Al-Qaeda sympathizer. The listeners are convinced that the man in Pakistan is super courier Al-Kuwaiti, and what he's saying astonishes them.
A lot of people will go back and say, you mean just one phone call was the basis for this break? And the answer is, it was one itty-bitty little screw-up. Just one. And that's all it takes.
After almost 10 years of searching, the CIA finally has a trace on a man who could break Al-Qaeda's leadership wide open. It throws everything it has into the effort to track al-Kuwaiti. Satellites with optical technology that can pick out an individual car from 600 miles above the ground. And a drone, a pilotless surveillance aircraft, carrying infrared and other sensors, cruising in near silence at over 50,000 feet, invisible to Pakistani radar. It's so secret that at first it does not have an official name, only a nickname, the Beast of Kandahar. Data from the satellites and drones is beamed back to the U.S. in real time. Dozens of CIA trackers and analysts can watch every journey Kuwaiti makes, and one of them is totally unexpected. They think bin Laden is hiding in the Afghan-Pakistan tribal belt, protected by the Taliban.
We believe he's along the Afghan-Pakistan border, was the answer I would routinely give.
They think Kuwaiti's SUV will head toward the Afghan mountains. But to the surprise and disappointment of the watchers, he turns in the opposite direction, toward the major cities of urban Pakistan, and drives to the upscale town of Abbottabad, home of the Pakistan Military Academy. He stops at a residential compound in the outskirts of the city, in a well-to-do neighborhood that's home to retired Pakistani generals.
Once you look at the house in Abbottabad, which is kind of hiding in plain view, it's only hiding in plain view until you start really paying attention to it.
Al-Kuwaiti has led the CIA to what looks like his own home. But hopes rise again when they realize that other people live there too.
People's expectations were raised because we now had a location, which we never had before, of where this carrier might be.
The compound itself was very unique and unusual. It had clearly been built with the purpose of concealing the activity that happened within that compound.
Fences 10 to 12 feet tall, topped by razor wire. In other words, this place says, don't come in here, we don't want you.
In Washington, astonishing questions are being whispered. Could al-Kuwaiti be the personal courier of al-Qaeda's leader? And could this fortress-like compound actually be home to Osama bin Laden? CIA Director Leon Panetta briefs President Barack Obama about a breakthrough in the hunt for Osama bin Laden.
He says, I'm with the people I was before.
Leon came into my office. He said, Mr. President, it's been a year since you told me that this needed to be your number one priority. And we have a bin Laden courier who we've been able to identify for the first time.
The drone images in front of you show him entering a compound.
Al-Qaeda's most important courier has led them to a compound in Pakistan.
Leon, I think properly, was cautious in saying that they could say definitively this was where bin Laden was. My feeling at the time was interested, but cautious.
Here you are, with a pretty good lead. You really want to be sure, before you roll those dice, that this is really worth it.
If we were going to embark on any kind of assault on this compound, which was in Pakistan, we had to make darn sure that we knew what we were talking about.
And he told Leon, let's make sure that we pull this string as quickly as possible. If he's there, time is of the essence.
The CIA moves fast on one of the most important and expensive surveillance missions in its history.
If you look at the area around Abbottabad, it's surrounded by low-lying foothills with higher mountains around it. These are ideal overwatch positions.
Agents who look Pakistani and speak Urdu move into an empty house overlooking the compound and begin to watch everything that happens there.
Who lived in the compound? What was there? Were there guards? Were there people walking around inside with guns?
When you're talking about this kind of surveillance, it's persistence. It never turns off. It's staring.
This is pattern of life surveillance, every detail in and around the compound, meticulously logged day and night.
Maybe you can follow them out to the grocery store and find out which vendor is actually supplying it to them.
It's a painstaking process of accumulating evidence. Very rarely do you get a smoking gun that tells you, okay, here's the shot you need to take, and it's there right in front of you. Most of the time, you have to piece it together.
They discover that Al-Kuwaiti and his brother live in the compound with their two families, and that they are great believers in privacy. They have enough money for nice cars, but their home has no telephone line or internet connection. They grow their own food and slaughter their own animals, and they are careful to burn all their trash. This is a dangerous place for Americans to operate.
Here you have this very secure complex, less than half a mile from the Pakistani equivalent of West Point. There's a lot of military in those areas.
But the pressure is on to find out as much as possible, as quickly as possible.
My greatest fear was that there may have been something either in that compound or in the surrounding area that we had no insight into. And so we tried to get as much information as possible with our limited collection capabilities that we had.
Whenever they can, they follow Kuwaiti on his travels. He goes dozens of miles to make a single call and never uses his phone anywhere near the compound. He drives for half a day to visit internet cafes and rarely visits the same one twice. He carries his own memory stick and removes every trace of his work from the computers that he uses. These extreme security precautions only heighten CIA suspicion. They are certain he is the eyes and ears of a major Al-Qaeda leader. But which one? When a stray cricket ball is hit over the fence, Kuwaiti and his brother won't let the local children in to collect it. They pay the kids, then destroy the ball. The local boys find this routine lucrative. More balls fly in, and more cash comes out. The CIA can only watch, hoping that greedy kids don't spook the inhabitants and make them run. Occasionally, they glimpse other people moving around inside the compound. It's a third family living on the top floor, even more private than the Kuwaitis. Women and children who never go to the market or to school. And a man who sometimes comes out to walk in the garden, but never leaves the compound. The watchers, the satellites, and the drones, all of them focus on this one man. They call him the Pacer. Could he really be Osama bin Laden? And how can they prove it?
The intelligence community came to the conclusion that a high-value target was at this compound, and that this high-value target might be Osama bin Laden. And at the end of the day, this was a circumstantial case. What more could we do to give ourselves a higher degree of certainty?
One of the few things that bin Laden can't change about himself is his height, 6'4". Working from little more than a dot in the surveillance imagery, U.S. intelligence analysts tried to calculate the size of the Pacer. By measuring his shadow and comparing it to the angle of the sun, they get an approximate height. He's clearly tall, but try as they might, they can't get an exact figure. Some of those watching and analyzing think it's bin Laden. Some of them don't. And everyone knows that he's used body doubles before.
Often we would get excited about little bits and pieces, but realized we had to put a full mosaic of information together to actually get to the prize of finding bin Laden.
Experts on body language and voice stress re-examine Al-Qaeda videos. Over the years, he's changed. He looks and sounds more relaxed, better fed, rested, and calm. Could it be that he's actually living in a house rather than roughing it in a cave?
This is some surveillance footage, a drone footage of a vehicle that we identified going towards the compound.
The CIA lays its latest evidence before the president and suggests that bin Laden may indeed be living in the compound.
Our intelligence officers were able to build a case that increased our confidence that there was a good likelihood bin Laden might be there.
One of the things the president said is that, okay, now we have an intelligence base, we have a possible location where he is, I want to understand exactly what our options are to get him.
The president orders the CIA to develop options for attacking the compound. Leon Panetta immediately contacts the Joint Special Forces Operations Command, or JSOC, America's warrior elite.
This better be important.
JSOC's commander is Vice Admiral Bill McRaven.
Admiral, good to see you again. Blueprints?
Thick walls.
I've known Bill for a number of years, and he's a very cool and collected individual.
We have a lot of control here.
He is an extraordinarily gifted, talented, and intellectual person, capable of incredible feats of planning and violence.
So somebody important must be staying here. The whole compound is completely walled in.
Meetings between the two men are top secret. McRaven is ordered to plan an attack, but not to reveal the target.
He's been through many, many of these types of operations before in Iraq and Afghanistan. He has the experience, the expertise, and we were relying heavily on it.
I'll leave all this with you. You can formulate plans once we get the go-ahead.
Will do.
As the CIA scours Abbottabad for clues, Osama bin Laden continues to run Al-Qaeda. Sending out operational commands, making tapes that urge his followers to strike the U.S. and the West. He's somewhere living in comfort, but prepared to run at any moment. With an emergency supply of cash sewn into the folds of his robe. After weeks of planning, Leon Panetta and Admiral McRaven present three options to the president.
I've prepared a presentation to show you our options. And
one, cooperate with Pakistan. This approach is quickly rejected.
There was always a prospect that if we brought the Pakistanis into it, inadvertently or even intentionally, that that information could get out and it could compromise the integrity of the mission.
On one level, they cooperate with us. We're friends. At another level, they're following their own strategy, which is completely at odds with us. So some people have referred to this relationship as a frenemy, as a friendly enemy.
It would not have occurred to me to inform the Pakistanis.
Bombing raid with B-2. Two, a devastating strike at the compound from the air. But it will take 32 2,000-pound bombs to ensure that the compound and any underground tunnels are completely destroyed.
Collateral damage would have been unacceptable.
Bombing means civilian casualties and no way of identifying who is dead.
I thought it was important, if we were going to go in, into a sovereign country, that we had to have some proof that in fact it was bin Laden rather than just firing a missile into a compound.
There would have been no way to actually ensure that we were certain that we got bin Laden with some type of bombing effort.
3. Send a commando force into the heart of Pakistan. A daring option that will put American lives on the line.
We're talking about a very high-risk operation here. Actual boots on the ground. Nothing scares politicians more than us putting American boots on foreign soil, especially foreign soil that belongs to a supposed ally.
Everyone in the room remembers the images of U.S. troops getting dragged through the streets of Mogadishu.
We lost 5 Blackhawks, one of those mine. I spent 11 days in captivity. During that time, I had a broken leg, broken back, broken cheekbone, nose, eye socket. I was shot.
And everyone also remembers the loss of life and political disaster when President Carter sent U.S. Special Forces to rescue American hostages in Tehran.
To my deep regret, 8 of the crewmen of the 2 aircraft which collided were killed. The responsibility is fully my own.
Ordering a helicopter raid like this poses a challenge for any president.
Some missions are going to be, by definition, dangerous. That's why the president, I think, really agonized over this decision. He wanted to make sure he had as much information as possible, and the burden of that decision was going to be on his shoulders for the rest of his life, and he knew that.
Thank you. That's the end of the presentation, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen.
President Obama keeps the bombing option on the table, but asks Admiral McCraven to start rehearsing for a raid immediately. He turns to America's leading clandestine warriors, the Navy SEALs. Admiral Bill McCraven is directed to plan a helicopter raid on a compound deep in Pakistan. He will work with America's leading counterterrorism force, the Navy SEALs, Team Number 6.
Team 6 is the clandestine end of American Special Operations. This is where the commandos, the snake eaters, and the ninjas go. These are the people who are conducting the really classified, really high risk, high payoff operations.
You want to break into a bank vault in Baghdad. I mean, who does these things? Well, it's these guys.
Candidates go through shattering endurance tests.
Get down in the mud and start crawling! Get in the mud!
It takes about 3.5 years for an individual, once he raises his hand, I want to be a United States Navy SEAL, before he's placed into combat the first time. And the attrition rate is about 80 to 85%. If there's someone out there that is better than you, you need to get on the horse and ride a little harder, because you're supposed to be the number one guy.
McRaven recreates every detail of the Pakistani compound in scale models.
Including women, children, more than 10.
His men have attacked dozens of places like this, and the plan is based on that experience. 23 SEALs and 1 interpreter in 2 helicopters. 6 men will man the perimeter. 6 others will rappel down onto the roof on ropes, then fight their way down into the house.
The interior of this place is like a maze.
12 more will land on the ground, enter the house, and fight upward. There will be nowhere for the occupants to escape.
Don't get caught there. Okay, make it so.
The SEALs will have to make split-second decisions and be prepared for anything they encounter.
You can be surprised, but even being surprised doesn't mean you're paralyzed. And that there are options available to you, and you have to continue to have momentum, and you have to win. And it's not a game.
To hone their skills, they train to identify friend or foe, Al-Qaeda member or civilian, instantly and in the dark. They quickly construct a full-scale model of the compound to rehearse in. They'll need to find their way around the compound at night, maybe surrounded by smoke and under fire.
They probably shoot well over 1,000 rounds a week through their primary weapon, just so they have the muscle memory for that particular gun to be able to know exactly where a bullet's going to go in a room.
Doors will have to be breached.
3, 2, 1.
there may be suicide bombers.
What?
And gunmen hidden around every corner.
Those raiders will study a compound to the point where they can actually draw pictures from memory and close their eyes and pace off and walk to doors, knowing with assurance they're going to be there.
They'll have to get in and get out fast. McRaven sets a time limit, just 30 minutes on the ground. He wants his men in the air and flying back toward Afghanistan before the Pakistani military realizes what is happening, merely a mile from its own staff college. As the SEALs prepare, President Obama considers his options under the most extreme secrecy. Only a handful of people across government are invited to so-called ghost meetings, without aides or deputies. Even presidential advisors are kept in the dark.
There started to be a set of meetings in late 2010 into 2011 that were unmarked. The topic wasn't listed on the manifest. There are cameras, actually, to see who's in there. Those cameras were turned off for these meetings. I was a little nervous about what was going on, why didn't I know about it? But nobody wanted to talk about that, right? Because you don't want to talk about the meeting you're not invited to.
White House staffers worry about being excluded from meetings. The SEALs worry about crossing into Pakistan's airspace.
Pakistan has, over the years, built up a fairly sophisticated radar system which is interconnected among the various sites, particularly the major airfields.
To help his men avoid detection as they fly in and out of Abbottabad, McRaven puts in a request for clandestine helicopters equipped with the latest stealth technology.
They've had special treatments added to them, new skins and structures, new rotors that reduce not only their radar signature, but also their acoustic signature. They don't sound like normal helicopters. They don't act like normal helicopters.
For every shooter, there's, 100 support people that are behind him, making sure that they find the right equipment. If there's a better piece of equipment or hardware out there, they'll go out and find it. Because we need to keep this group at the cutting edge.
I think what's most impressive about this mission is the fact that nobody knew that these aircraft existed.
They'll be flown by America's elite helicopter pilots, the Night Stalkers, a unit created specially for operations like this. Along with the SEALs' usual armory of M4 and Heckler & Koch rifles and P226 pistols, there's also Cairo.
There is a specially trained special operations dog, a Belgian Malamute, which is specially equipped with body armor, a helmet. It's also a formidable offensive weapon. Those dogs have huge mouths of teeth.
And despite weeks of training for dog and man, none of the SEALs yet know who the target is.
It wasn't because no one trusts these guys. Everyone trusts these guys. It was because this was such a highly compartmentalized, highly secret operation that by its own very nature, you don't tell people anything they don't need to know until they absolutely need to know them.
After spending weeks as an anxious outsider, it's now Ben Rhodes' turn to know the greatest secret in the U.S.
Sat me down and said, there's something we need to tell you. It was an extraordinary moment, and I think I felt the enormous weight of the information I'd been told. When you're in these jobs, you learn a lot of secrets, but this was different. It's Osama bin Laden, after all, and you're anxious about it, you're excited about it, you're nervous about it. The inclination is to want to discuss that with people, but you really had to be in the utmost vigilance about protecting this information.
One of the president's deepest concerns is how to rescue the SEALs if things go wrong.
The president directed that I want to make sure that we do everything possible to get those U.S. forces out. Didn't want to leave anybody behind, didn't want to take on casualties.
McRaven's solution? A powerful second force. 56 men in two Chinook helicopters will fly two-thirds of the way to Abbottabad, waiting deep inside Pakistan with extra fuel supplies in case the SEALs need help to fight their way home.
He would never overpromise And he told the president very directly, Mr. President, we haven't thoroughly tested this out yet, so I can't tell you whether or not we can do it. But when we do, I'll come back to you and I'll tell you straight up.
Mr. President, we're going to plan for this.
But I will tell you, if we can't do this, then we can't do this.
1703, clear to land.
On Tuesday, April 26th, the SEALs fly to Jalalabad, Afghanistan, poised to strike into Pakistan at a moment's notice. McRaven wants to attack on a night without moonlight. The next moonless period starts in just 3 days. But even as the SEALs are flying to their forward base in Jalalabad, in Washington, there's a big problem. After watching the compound in Abbottabad for 8 months, the CIA puts the probability of Osama bin Laden being there at between 60 and 70%. Is that enough to justify the risk of sending troops into the heart of Pakistan?
As we got closer and closer to actually making a decision, clearly things became more intense.
Admiral McRaven wants to attack on a moonless night. The next period without moonlight is in 3 days. He needs a decision soon. President Obama calls for a final review of the intelligence.
At the end, there was a recommendation that we conduct a red team exercise.
A red team is a small group of independent analysts brought in from outside the CIA.
We did ask the red team to have analysts who had not been involved at all in the process, who had not taken positions on anything, who were not at all invested in the operation, to come in and take a fresh eyes look at it.
And they have just a few days to deliver their verdict. The president has told Admiral McRaven that he will get his answer today. But first he hears the results of the red team's work. 40 to 60%, significantly lower than the CIA's figure. The red team assesses the probability of bin Laden being in the compound as low as 40%.
And when some of the principals heard that, it was like, whoa, wait a minute. We thought it was, the prospects were higher of his being there. And the president recognized that when people were saying, well, it's only 40% of the chance, that some people were going to get a little bit soft on this.
It was a deflation in the room, because what you're looking for as you're getting closer to the call is greater certainty, not less. So essentially it played into all of the fears that people had about what could go wrong. Is this worth the risk?
This reduction in confidence is partly due to events in the compound. There have been some high-profile visitors recently, men known to be connected to Al-Qaeda.
There were some things that were anomalous. People did go in and out. They did have some people who were entering the compound.
Bin Laden has always been intensely careful about personal contacts. That's what's kept him alive for so long. Would he really meet with Al-Qaeda sympathizers? Men he knows that the U.S. can track? Perhaps the man being protected by the Kuwaiti brothers might be someone less important.
Some of our intelligence officers thought that it was only a 40 or 30% chance that bin Laden was in the compound. Others thought it was as high as 80 or 90%. At the conclusion of a fairly lengthy discussion where everybody gave their assessments, I said, this is basically 50-50. It was circumstantial. We couldn't know for certain.
Faced with the decision of a lifetime, the president asks each member of his national security team for their final thoughts.
It's a hard call.
That is a tough call, Mr. President.
Everybody prefaced their remarks by talking about what a difficult decision this was. I remember multiple principals saying, this is a really hard call, Mr. President.
Everyone knows the history of false hopes and failed missions. Only half of them are for the raid.
People gave their, I think, very honest and candid views about the strength of the information, and there was not unanimity in the room.
He received divided counsel. There were some of his most senior advisors who advocated against doing this, thought it was too risky, thought the case too circumstantial.
At the end of that meeting, which was fairly tense, I told folks that I would sleep on it and I would give an order in the morning.
Since 1996, Osama bin Laden has planned and plotted against the United States and its allies. He spends April 2011 preparing attacks on Americans as they make plans to commemorate the 10th anniversary of 9/11.
He was operationally important to Al-Qaeda. He still directed Al-Qaeda. He was not just a symbolic leader, but he made decisions about the way Al-Qaeda functioned, who they recruited, who they targeted.
And bin Laden has told his commanders that one target matters to him more than any other.
Do so at the will of our people.
But will Barack Obama decide to strike first?
That you will determine your own destiny.
In minutes, the president will announce his decision to the key members of his security team.
This is the third president I've served, and those moments still really strike me, that we ask one person in our system to make these incredibly difficult calls on behalf of 300 million Americans.
Obviously, I knew that if we were unsuccessful, there was the potential for not only loss of life, the incredibly brave SEALs who were going in, but also there'd be huge geopolitical ramifications.
And at the end of the day, only the president can weigh those risks. What's in the nation's interest? What will we accomplish if this works? How will I deal with it if it doesn't work? It was a quintessential presidential decision.
We were all waiting with bated breath to get the final decision back from him.
The stakes were just too damn high.
He said, I've thought about the options, I've considered the decision, and it's a go.
Even though I thought it was only 50-50 that bin Laden was there, I thought it was worth us taking a shot.
For someone like a bin Laden, the president knew that we'd have to go forward, even if the case was circumstantial, even if the risks were significant.
It was a very powerful feeling to know that there's something that you've been planning for is suddenly really about to happen.
In Abbottabad, the CIA surveillance team is told to pack up and melt into the background. In Jalalabad, Afghanistan, the SEALs get ready, but they still don't know who the target is. On Friday night, Admiral McCraven gets a weather report and decides that Sunday is the best time to attack. If it really is bin Laden in the compound, will he still be there on Sunday? With the rescheduled raid less than a day away and the weather improving, SEAL Team 6 prepares for battle. In Washington, President Obama attends the city's most glittering event of the year.
I always describe these White House correspondents' dinners as Washington's Oscar weekend. It really is a chance for Washington to let its hair down.
The president and his national security aides had to go forward with the dinner, because if he had canceled, it would have signaled to the press corps that something was up, would have sent them digging.
Obama's team has to protect its secret, but there's a dangerous mix in the room. Journalists, White House insiders, and alcohol. If someone makes a single indiscreet comment, then it's all over.
We knew that if this information appeared in any newspaper in the world, chances are the next day that compound would be empty. And we lived in fear of that.
People think bin Laden is hiding in the Hindu Kush, but did you know that every day from 4 to 5 he hosts a show on C-SPAN?
It would have been incredible to just be inside his head at that moment. What was he really thinking? You know, he could have been sitting there laughing and saying, oh my, little do they know what is about ready to go down. Or it may be, oh no, they're joking about something right now that could undo me.
Admiral McCraven gives SEAL Team 6 its final briefing. They've been training for 30 days and they still don't know who their target is. That's about to change. They receive printed details of everyone believed to live inside the compound.
The name of the target for this mission, gentlemen, is Osama bin Laden.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
It is wonderful to be here at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. What a week.
To keep the mission under wraps, the White House has canceled all public tours scheduled for the next day.
It didn't occur to us until late the day before that we'd have to cancel all these tours and essentially lock down the White House, make it a zone where nobody could come in except for people who had something to do with this operation.
This news attracts the interest of political correspondent George Stephanopoulos.
George Stephanopoulos leans over to the White House Chief of Staff, Bill Daley, and says, what, you guys got something big going on over there? Daley is one of the very few people in the room who knows the biggest secret in the world at this moment. And Daley is momentarily spooked, doesn't really know what to say. He says, no, it's just a plumbing issue. And that evidently satisfied George Stephanopoulos.
If presented by threat, shoot to kill. His code name for this operation is Geronimo. Carry on.
SEAL Team 6 prepares to embark on another dangerous mission with the highest stakes. Back in Washington, everything needs to appear normal. The president continues his routine with a Sunday morning round of golf.
What was interesting, and I remember thinking about this at the time, is that the president normally would go out and play a full round of 18 holes, but he cut it short. It was 9 holes that the president played.
While the president is on the golf course, his national security advisors assemble in the White House, a meeting kept tightly secret.
That morning, the CIA director, Leon Panetta, went to church. Director of National Intelligence, James Clapper, told his wife that he had to go to the White House for some meetings all day.
No one can reveal the real reason for going into work this Sunday.
As the forces at the White House started to muster, they were asked not to leave their hardened limousines and SUVs in the narrow driveway next to the West Wing. The press can see that driveway.
We knew that Sunday, May 1st, would be an extraordinary day at the White House. We knew that we would be in the Situation Room the entire day. And so we took several steps to set up. We made the large conference room essentially our command center. They installed a set of secure phones. We established a secure video link to both the CIA headquarters and out to Bill McCraven.
They order pizza from lots of different places so that nobody in the pizza delivery business in Washington would tip off the press that the White House suddenly ordered 20 pizzas, because historically that's a tip-off that something is happening. All of these little tricks, they worked because nobody knew.
One of the remarkable things about this whole operation was that we had been able to keep it absolutely secret, despite the fact that by the time I ordered the raid, there were probably several hundred people who knew about the mission.
As you get closer to an operation, you actually get more fearful of the things that could go wrong. You're feeling an extraordinary sense of anticipation, nervousness. You want the time of the operation to arrive.
In Pakistan, it's already dusk. The coming night will be dark and moonless. Perfect conditions for stealth flying. Somewhere, Osama bin Laden is preparing for another night in hiding. President Obama is gambling on the hope that the Al-Qaeda leader is inside the mysterious compound in Abbottabad. Go or no go? If he wants to change his mind, this is his last chance. He does not. And in Jalalabad, the SEALs head toward their helicopters. Two Chinook helicopters, carrying 56 extra troops, will accompany the two Black Hawk helicopters containing the main SEAL Team 6 strike force of 24 men. The Chinooks will refuel the strike force on its flight home, or rescue them if all goes wrong. For everyone involved, it's a 90-minute flight into the unknown.
There is nobody, from the guy who pushes the broom at Fort Bragg all the way to Bill McRaven, who didn't want to be on those helicopters carrying a gun. Once-in-a-lifetime operation, these guys. Once-in-a-lifetime chance. They were getting to go and kill the most wanted man on the planet.
SEAL Team 6 flies toward Pakistan in two stealth Black Hawk helicopters. Two larger Chinooks carry fuel and a backup force. If they are detected on the 90-minute journey, the Pakistanis could shoot them all down. So it's radio silence. Communication by secure text only. In Afghanistan, Admiral McRaven is in contact with the SEALs and with CIA Chief Leon Panetta in Langley, Virginia. Panetta and McRaven will relay a blow-by-blow account to the White House. From here, President Obama and his staff will watch the most important U.S. Special Forces operation in 30 years. In real time.
I remember a feeling of trying to pass the time because these minutes felt like hours. And you're really not in a state of excitement, but rather of extraordinary concern.
Might there be a quick reaction force that bin Laden would have had, security that we didn't know about? Was the compound booby-trapped? Would have there been a series of detonations that would have killed our forces? You know, so it was nail-biting time, and we were holding our breath.
Can you hear me, Admiral McRaven?
Yes, Leon, I can hear you.
Our prayers and confidence with you and your men.
Standing by.
On the helicopter, your adrenaline starts pumping. There's a lot to think about. What their first objective has to be, how they're going to get there, whether they're going to climb it, whether they're going to blast through it, whether they're going to throw a line over it. If you're a sniper, you know, what areas are your responsibility? Everyone has their job to do. And the good thing about this unit is everyone does it really well.
The helicopters have radar-evading stealth technology and rotors adjusted to make the minimum noise possible. At the controls are the Night Stalkers, with years of experience flying at low levels in hostile environments.
Flying with the Night Stalkers is something you have to experience to believe it happens. These are people who fly right at the edge of the helicopter's performance. They will go and get as close to the ground as they can to conceal themselves from radar and other detection.
We call it contour flight, which is primarily following the contour of the Earth. At night, there's a threat of hitting an obstacle that you just can't see that isn't on the chart. You know, flying 110, 130 miles an hour isn't fast when you're at 10,000 feet. But when you're down at 100 feet, it seems pretty fast.
They had to do this for roughly 90 minutes. As you're doing it, the pilots and crews are looking up, and there are mountains on either side of them. There are trees that may be brushing against the bottoms of the aircraft.
Black Hawk 1 will land just outside the compound, and its 12 SEALs will enter the house from the ground. Black Hawk 2 will hover over the main house so that six of the SEALs can rappel down directly onto the roof.
It increases the chance of success tremendously if you can attack the enemy from multiple access points, meaning, you know, if you can come from the rooftop down simultaneously as you're coming from the ground up, that's going to increase the chance of success. So to do that, you're going to need at least two helicopters or more.
The two teams will meet in the middle of the house, leaving no escape route. The SEALs are prepared for booby traps, for people armed with weapons, and for Al-Qaeda's signature weapon, the suicide belt. They're ordered to spare civilians if possible, but shoot anyone who poses a threat.
You've now entered Pakistan airspace.
I realized after those helicopters took off that I wouldn't be sitting in the room if it weren't for 9/11. I saw those Twin Towers get hit with airplanes, and that's when I decided that I wanted to move down to Washington and try to be a part of whatever was going to happen next. You're sitting there thinking through all those things. Your personal story, the story of the country, what's going to be going through the minds of people who lost loved ones to bin Laden. All those things, I think, were weighing very heavily on all of us in the Situation Room.
SEAL Team 6 have now crossed into Pakistan airspace.
If the Pakistanis pick up the slightest blip on the radar, this could be considered an act of war.
You're going to be on the clock. You're going to only have about an hour to an hour and a half inside Pakistani airspace where you're going to be able to operate. Beyond that, the Pakistanis are going to rightfully be entitled to launch F-16s and shoot you down.
Clear comms.
Go channel 2. Stand by.
The two Chinooks follow the Black Hawks into Pakistan, with backup troops and fuel for the getaway. To avoid the radar systems around the military bases in Abbottabad, the Chinooks land 65 miles short of the town, in a quiet rural area. The troops disembark and set up a perimeter, and then wait to see if the SEALs are going to need them. The two Blackhawks, carrying 23 SEALs, a military interpreter, and a dog called Cairo, push on toward their target.
It's dark, it's pretty quiet. What you're doing is you're just concentrating on what the first step's gonna be. I never thought about life and death and whether I was gonna get killed or not or injured. I just thought about doing my job. Your adrenaline starts pumping. You know, you're thinking about what I'm gonna do first, what am I gonna do first, what am I gonna do first.
They approach the compound. They hover over it. But there's a problem.
Black Hawk 1 appears to be in trouble.
The hot night air and the compound's high walls create an environment every helicopter pilot dreads. A column of air that can't escape and kills the lift supplied by the rotor blades.
Anytime you have a rotary wing aircraft in tight quarters, in an urban environment, there's a risk.
It's called recirculation. At this height, it can be deadly. Black Hawk 1 starts to fall and spin. Its pilot struggles for control.
Reporting to
you. Everybody in that room has just suffered a severe scare. There's no way their brains did not go back to Mogadishu in 93 and to Iran in 1980.
We were able to monitor the situation in real time. We could see that there were problems initially with one of the helicopters landing.
Black Hawk 1 is down.
So right off the top, everybody, I think, was holding their breath. That wasn't in the script.
The raid on the compound in Pakistan has only just begun, and already it's in deep trouble. SEAL Team 6 has a Black Hawk down. The helicopter that was meant to deposit 12 SEALs on the ground has crash-landed yards away from the target. The president and his security team watch helplessly the images filmed by a pilotless drone thousands of feet above the site. They are riveted to the words of Mission Commander Admiral Bill McRaven.
People were making eye contact with each other around the room. They weren't speaking, but would kind of make eye contact and make a concerned raise of the eyebrow.
Everybody was quiet, and we were just listening and trying to figure out what happened. We had a sense that despite the helicopter having landed in a violent way, that the passengers inside had not been hurt and that they were still going through with the mission.
This is one of the things about this level of special mission unit operator. All of them, whatever their conditions were, within seconds, were back in the fight.
McRaven is ready with a backup plan.
Black Hawk 2, abandon roof option.
Land outside compound.
Admiral McRaven was extraordinarily unflappable and professional. His demeanor did not change. He relayed the information that they were prepared for this contingency and that his men would deal with it.
All the SEALs are now on the ground. They make their way to the main house. They only have one way to clear the building now. From the bottom up.
There's a lot of things that can go wrong, and you just need to prepare for them. It's kind of like the Terminator hand. You know, you just keep going, keep going.
The SEALs move toward the main house with unknowns around every corner.
The most dangerous aspect of this operation, in my mind, is going into an urban environment where you really don't control the buildings around the compound. You have to fight your way into the compound. What if there are counter snipers? What if there's a tripwire?
As they approach their target, the SEALs split into smaller teams. But the noise from the crash has taken away their main advantage, surprise. The light goes on in the small guest house.
I didn't detect a single change in their tone of voice. It is just all straightforward. Incredible focus.
The SEALs identify the dead as Al-Kuwaiti and his wife and move on. The military town of Abbottabad is now fully awake, and locals are asking awkward questions. The SEAL's interpreter tries to deflect them. It's likely the Pakistani military won't be far behind. One of the fire teams spots a man running into the main house. They are now 7 minutes into the raid, but the SEALs have yet to enter the house.
Don't know whether the main house is rigged with explosive devices. You don't know whether or not there's superior force inside.
They start breaching doors, apparently going somewhere. And what they find are brick walls behind them. Barricades. The raiding team took along an adequate supply of everything from shotgun shells to breaching charges to go ahead and frankly level the house if they had needed to.
The SEALs now in the house. The Situation Room can no longer monitor their progress on video.
We have lost visual.
We were really in a blackout situation. It was hard for us to know what exactly was taking place. We knew gunshots were taking place. We knew some explosions were taking place.
We were holding our breath. A lot of our minds were racing toward, you know, worst case scenarios.
The SEALs start to clear, starting with the ground floor and working toward the top. But it won't be easy.
One of the things they immediately notice is there's only the one staircase that they can use. Anybody defending the building knows they're going to have to come up this staircase. This is dangerous. This is not good.
All it takes is for a lone gunman to lean over the railings and spray them with bullets or throw down a grenade. On the first floor, they encounter a man running toward them on the stairs. They shoot him dead.
You're looking at an individual. You're identifying the individual. You're determining whether he's a threat or not. And you're engaging it in a snap of the finger. That's what these guys are trained to do. And they should be trained to do that, because that's what keeps them alive.
The U.S. government will later describe this as a kill or capture mission. But nobody in this house has any doubt about what the SEALs have come to do tonight. Al-Kuwaiti's brother emerges. The SEALs kill him, too. They begin to encounter women and children.
And a child with a suicide belt or with a weapon that's pointing at you and squeezes the trigger will kill you just as fast as an adult. Female, male, old, young, if it's a threat, you engage. If it's not a threat, you don't.
They would go grab them, restrain them with wrist cuffs, and move them out of the way, and they continue to move up the stairs.
A SEAL glimpses a figure at the top of the stairs. It's the man they've come looking for.
They look up through the central well of the building, and there, up on the third floor, they see bin Laden. It is the first time American eyes have laid sight on him in 10 years.
They take a shot and miss, and pursue the man they believe to be Bin Laden deeper into the building. Using Bin Laden's code name of Geronimo, a dramatic message flashes to the Situation Room.
Confirmed. Geronimo has been sighted.
Admiral McRaven has confirmed Geronimo has been sighted.
You know, he's there. But you still didn't know what was going to happen. And there was a lot of concern about, was the compound going to be booby-trapped? Were there going to be explosions? Would Bin Laden be wearing a suicide vest?
The assumption was that Bin Laden would never go down willingly, that he would not be taken peacefully, that he would engage, or those around him would engage in a firefight.
U.S. Navy SEALs enter a bedroom in a house in Pakistan in search of Osama bin Laden. A woman moves toward them. They shoot her in the leg. They're now face to face with the man they have come to kill.
One great image that comes out of this is the fact that bin Laden's final sight on this earth was the muzzle of a U.S. Navy SEAL. For those of us who've been looking for bin Laden for a long time, to know that that was the last thing that he saw is actually a moment of joy.
It's confirmed, Geronimo, EKIA.
It was announced that Geronimo, the code name they developed for bin Laden, was EKIA, enemy killed in action.
Gasps, literally. The president just said, we got him. We got him.
This was a big gamble, and I think at the time I said something very brief. I said, we got him. But there was no whooping, there was no hollering, there was no high-fiving inside the Situation Room. At that point, all of us were focused on, are these guys going to get out safely?
The SEALs have been on the ground for 20 minutes. They have just 10 minutes left to complete the raid. And there is no certainty that the man they shot is Osama bin Laden.
The early reports were that the individual that we believe bin Laden was taken down. We weren't certain that it was him until we could do a more extensive identification check.
The team has just a few minutes to do all it can to identify the man they shot. They use an unorthodox method to gauge his height.
Interestingly, they didn't have a tape measure to go ahead and measure him. One of his defining qualities was that he was very tall. And so one of the taller SEALs actually laid down next to the body for them to make sure that he was of the required height to be bin Laden. They took facial recognition photos, uplinked them back to the forensics database people in Afghanistan and Washington.
Standing by for visual
confirmation.
Stand by for identification.
When you look at an individual, it's different than you're looking at a poster. You know, there's doubles. And you look at an individual and you go, you know what, I think that's bin Laden. Would you stake your kid's life on it? Well, there's a hesitation. That's why you do DNA.
For accurate DNA testing, they'll have to wait until several hours after they get the body back to their base in Jalalabad.
All of us, I think, took pause, not wanting to get too excited, number one, because they're operating in pitch darkness and identification could not be certain. Number two, our guys still weren't out of there and we had one helicopter sitting in the middle of a compound.
With one Black Hawk down, there isn't enough room for everyone on the remaining Black Hawk helicopter. So the two backup Chinook helicopters come to the rescue to take the SEALs, the body, and any evidence of Al-Qaeda's activities out of the country. But the Chinooks can be detected by Pakistani radar, and their deafening engines wake the military town of Abbottabad. In a nearby building, a web designer begins to tweet.
A helicopter hovering above Abbottabad at 1 a.m. is a rare event.
The SEALs have been on the ground 33 minutes. According to plan, they should have left 3 minutes ago. They are now taking a big risk, as the Pakistani military could arrive at any second. The most critical part of their mission is to bring back the dead man's body. If they have indeed killed Osama bin Laden, this is their only proof. Back in the compound, other SEAL teams still need to complete their search.
We only have minutes to go through this entire three-story building, plus the outbuildings, the garbage areas and such, and grab anything that they were going to for later examination by the intelligence community.
Brick walls.
In one of the rooms, they discover what they're looking for. A huge cache of intelligence, including Al-Qaeda's plans for terrorist attacks across the world.
He left a tremendous digital trail that for any intelligence professional is a treasure trove. And that I thought was a bit surprising.
Garbage bags full, you know, big old burly special operations guys literally hauling this stuff back to the Chinook as fast as they could.
One critical decision remains. What to do about the crashed helicopter?
You can't take the helicopter with you. So your choices are, do you leave it intact and ask for it back, or do you destroy it?
They can't afford to let $60 million worth of stealth technology fall into enemy hands. But the explosion caused by destroying the helicopter is sure to alert the Pakistani authorities. It's a risk they have to take. While one team flies out with the body, a second team guards the women and children that are all being left behind.
Another team was going back to the wreckage and setting demolition charges to destroy the avionics, the crypto gear, and the mission computer inside.
For safe measure, they roll thermite grenades inside the cockpit.
Firing!
SEALs have just announced their presence to the world. The Pakistani Air Force can scramble F-16s to Abbottabad in just 6 minutes. And the Black Hawk helicopter carrying the body still needs fuel to make it across the Afghan border.
There's a lot of things that can go wrong. You just need to prepare for them all the way to the finish.
An exploding Black Hawk helicopter rocks Abbottabad, home of the Pakistani Military Academy. News of the explosion reaches the outside world. The blast panics a web designer who tweets,
"A huge window shaking bang here in Abbottabad. I hope it's not the start of something nasty."
The SEALs should have left 8 minutes ago, and now their cover is blown. They have to get to the Afghan border before the Pakistani military can shoot them down. On board, they carry the body of the man they believe is Osama bin Laden. In Washington, D.C., President Obama and his team nervously wait for news.
I think everybody was very cautious at that point in jumping to the conclusion that this had been successful.
The return flight, arguably, is one of the riskier phases. And you can let your guard down very easily. You can't forget, I'm still flying a helicopter. It's still nighttime. The Pakistanis are still out there. The wires are still there. The towers are still there. You know, all those hazards that were there on the way in are still there.
Then my only concern was getting them over the border because they still needed to do some refueling.
Shortly before 3 a.m. in Afghanistan, 6 p.m. in Washington, the SEALs have refueled and finally land safely in Jalalabad.
It wasn't until they were safe and sound over Afghan territory that all of us breathed a sigh of relief.
The Pakistani military arrive at the compound to find the burning wreckage of a Black Hawk and several of bin Laden's family members.
That was a tense afternoon. It was the longest 40 minutes of my life other than when my daughter got sick at the age of 3 months and we were worried about whether she was going to be safe or not.
They fly the body they believe is Osama bin Laden to the aircraft carrier Carl Vinson in the North Arabian Sea for eventual burial. They will compare a DNA sample from the body to that of a known relative of bin Laden. Identifying the man shot by the SEALs is now everyone's top priority. The CIA uses facial recognition technology to analyze photographs of his face.
We had taken photographs, which we had actually seen inside the Situation Room, of the body. And we have analysts whose job it is to match up identities based on photographs.
At 6:40 p.m. in Washington, 2 hours after the raid, the results are ready.
It's a match.
It was their assessment that this was Osama bin Laden. And so we had a high degree of certainty at that point. We could not be 100% sure until we had the DNA.
The results from the DNA test won't be ready for another 8 hours. In Abbottabad, news is breaking about a crashed helicopter, rumored to be American. In the White House, pressure is mounting.
As soon as there were explosions on the ground in Pakistan, we knew that this was not going to remain secret for long. And there were immediately reports of people gathering on the scene, of media coming to the scene. And so we knew that the clock was then ticking.
At that point, what we knew was that the story was going to start breaking, that there are a lot of rumors floating around there, and at that point, we can't maintain secrecy any longer. So we thought it was most important, particularly given the fact that it had taken place in Pakistan, that we go ahead and definitively state, this is what happened, explain our actions.
At 8:35, 3 hours after the raid ended, President Obama orders an address to the nation.
It was a very intense period of time. I think it was less than 2 hours in which we were working on the draft. And we were editing it all the way up until when he walked out to deliver his remarks.
President Obama is about to make his announcement to the world without final DNA confirmation.
It wasn't really until Bill McCraven personally saw the body that we confirmed that, in fact, it was bin Laden. At that point, we were 99% certain.
In Jalalabad, Afghanistan, SEAL Team 6 gathers to watch.
I can report to the American people and to the world that the United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of al-Qaeda, and a terrorist who's responsible for the murder of thousands. A small team of Americans carried out the operation with extraordinary courage and capability. The death of bin Laden marks the most significant achievement to date in our nation's effort to defeat al-Qaeda.
As a result of this successful mission, we have said to the world, if you kill Americans, we're going to find you and we're going to bring you to justice.
Thanks for that. Yeah, I'm proud of it.
Your guests did a great job.
They did. The reason I'm calling is to tell you.
It's nice that the American people can celebrate, but this is one chapter in a long book, and it ain't over.
I think it was a somber moment for a lot of people. It made a lot of people reflect on, again, the people that we have lost as a result of bin Laden's terror over the years. It was more, I think, cathartic.
Early the next morning, DNA technicians confirm that the dead man is Osama bin Laden.
We decided that his remains would be buried at sea because we wanted to make sure that we were able to handle this situation appropriately.
We did not want bin Laden to be a martyr. It was a masterful move to have him dumped into the ocean. And the reason for that is that we didn't want to have a gravesite where, again, he would be a martyr and he would be bigger than life.
We looked at how we should handle his remains. We wanted to do it in the appropriate time frame because it needs to be done within 24 hours. This was a murderer, but yet we didn't want to do anything that was going to be deemed offensive to Islam. We gave it much more consideration and we gave it appropriate, you know, deference, more so than bin Laden gave to any single man, woman, or child that he killed. And it was long past time that his terror and his murder and the agony he caused people came to an end.
At around 2 a.m. in Washington, 11 a.m. in the North Arabian Sea, the wrapped body of Osama bin Laden was dropped from the USS Carl Vinson into the water. This final mission finishes the story of the world's most wanted man, who orchestrated the 9/11 attacks.